Hi everyone, this is Srihari. Hope everyone is doing good. So first of all, I would like to say thanks to Diana Initiative and Red Team Village for having me to take a session. So my topic is deploying discrete infrastructure for target phishing campaigns. So today I'm going to take a session on that particular topic. So let's say, who am I? So my name is Srihari Das. I'm a cybersecurity engineer at UST Global Trivandrum. I'm also a bug bounty hunter. I'm also a capture the flag player. I got 15 plus Hall of Fames from different companies. I got placed at 6th in Hack the Box platform. And I am a core member at DEFCON Trivandrum. I am an operator at Red Team Village. I do volunteering at Kerala Police Cyber Dome, and this is my Twitter. If you guys have any queries, you can just ping me there. I will be available to help you out. So, not wasting any time, I'll move to the next slide. So the agenda of this talk is to. So I am going to talk about phishing and how to set up a phishing infrastructure and how to set up a phishing framework. That is I'm going to show you is currently I think GoFish, and the next thing will be identifying a phishing email, that how we can identify a from an email that if it is a phishing mail or it's a genuine mail. So we'll do that also. The last one will be preventing from the phishing attacks, that what are the things that we can do from to not get in get caught in the attacker's hand. So how we can prevent that. So move back to the next slide. So I'll explain what is just give a brief idea about phishing. So phishing is phishing can be explained as an activity that I think it involves sending emails from a seemingly reputable source with a purpose to obtain personal information or influence email receivers. So in the sense, sending emails to victims, and they will the attacker will believe in them that this is a genuine mail and it came from a genuine source. That will be the attacker's motive, and he is his purpose is he would like to get the credentials, or he would like to capture or steal the banking details and critical informations from a user or a organization or any individuals. So that is actually, I think I can say that this is what basically phishing called. So to the next point, phishing practice combines both social engineering and technical skills. So in the sense, phishing comes under the social engineering attack. So phishing is part of one of the social engineering attacks, and yes, it needs some technical skills to do the phishing attacks. It's not that hard, but still it needs a little bit of skills. So sometimes phishing attacks will varies, and sometimes it will be there are multiple multiple attacks vectors, and it's like one of them is we are getting some mail and it has a malicious attachment, and a victim is or a user is supposed to click on that particular attachment, and what happens is when the user clicks, the attachment might be has a payload that injected onto that particular attachment, and once the user clicks on that, the payload will execute in the background, and the users machine or system will get compromised. So that's what basically happens. Also, phishing is a I think let's say a first level of attack vector or a first level of compromise when it's a redeeming or a adversary attack. The adversaries will try to get into a let's say an organization, a banking or any financial service. They use they most of the time they will use the targeted phishing, let's call it as also spear phishing. They will do spear phishing like most of the time. So the phishing is also part of I think let's say one of the biggest exploited vulnerability, I could say this in this COVID time. There are so many issues and so many phishing attacks has been happened, and we can hear that from the news. So phishing is a really bad kind of thing. So in this situation also. So move to the next part. What are the types of phishing? So there are multiple types of phishing here. As I said before, it has spear phishing in the sense it is a targeted kind of attacks that the user, the attacker will be targeting a particular user or a particular employer or a particular organization, and they will target and they will send phishing emails to a targeted person or an individual. So what the difference between spear phishing and the phishing attack is, spear phishing is all about it's like it's a targeted attack. It's not like a spray and pray attack. It won't like the usual phishing attacks. What the attacker will do is he will collect all the all the public emails that is available on the internet. He will just send the a phishing mail to all the emails that he got. But it this. The attacker is not that sure, or he's not 100% sure that the victim will get click or the victim will fall into his trap, because most of the time he's just sending it without any let's say motive. That is called as that is one of that is I think that is that can be called as regular phishing. And when it comes to spear phishing, it will be like a purely targeted attack. So it won't be like a spray and pray attack. It will be particularly focused on an individual, or if the attacker is focusing on a let's say an organization, so that the attacker will collect all the necessary data, informations with using OSINT and the publicly available data, and he will collect all that and he will launch the attack with a limited number of users. I think I could say maybe a limited number of users, and that is called spear phishing. So when it comes to veiling is I could say it's a let's say it's a executive level targeted attack. So the veiling attack is just targeting the executive level employees. I think the higher level employees, higher band employees, let's say C-level employees, directors and service managers and CEOs, CTOs and that kind of board members and that kind of persons. The veiling attack is targeting. So that is called veiling attack. So the next one will be clone phishing. Clone phishing in the sense, clone phishing has been done by let's say I'll give you an example. So one of the employee, let's let's say the abc.org, the in abc.org, let's say xyz employee's account has been breached, and let's say sre, that is another user. So xyz account was breached, and from the xyz's account the attacker has been sending a mail. Let's say the XYZ and SRE has been contacting through mail, so they has been regularly contacting. So the SRE doesn't know the XYZ's account has been breached, and what the XYZ, the attacker who breached the XYZ's account will do is he will look for the mail chain, and he will reply to a old mail chain or old mail that he has sent to SRE. So what will happen is SRE will think that it came from XYZ's account, and if the attacker will attach any kind of malicious documents or anything with that particular email, the SRE will thinks this comes from XYZ, and this is a genuine one. He will fall into the trap of the attacker, and he will SRE will operate, and he will get compromised. So that is called clone phishing, like cloning a particular mail email or replaying it to a previous mail. That's what it's called. So the next one will be voice phishing, or we can call it as vishing. So not all phishing attacks requires a fake website, because sometimes it a phishing doesn't need a website or anything. So it only need a call from a attacker. So I'll give you an example. Let's say there is a call that claims to be from a bank, and the caller or attacker has been told the users to dial a particular phone number, and regarding phone number with regarding a problem with their bank account. So when they once they dial that particular number that has been set by the phisher with using I think VoIP services, and the user first dialed, it will ask for the account number and pins, and sometimes credit card and debit card numbers also. So that's how a phishing attacks works. It's like calling to a mobile number and asking for a pin, and asking the user to call to a particular number, and then telling them to put their user account number and pin also. That comes under phishing. So moving to the next one, that is SMS phishing. SMS phishing, that is also called as smishing attacks. Smishing and smishing attacks are similar to phishing attacks also. Smishing attacks are typically invite the users to click a link or call to a number or contact an email address provided by the attacker via or through a SMS. For example, you will get an SMS that is saying that you are won $10,000 with you have won a lucky jackpot and you won $10,000. So what you have to do is you have to click this particular link, and you have to log into website, and you have to put your bank details or your address, emails, and that kind of things. And sometimes it will ask for your private data, and you have to sometimes it has a the SMS that the SMS says that you have to call to a particular number. So once we call to that, there will be maybe an automated service there, and they will ask for the your bank details, credentials, and that kind of things, and it will get stored. And your account, if you type or if you give it to them, then your account will get breached, and that will end up in a chaos. So I think that is all for the types of phishing. We will move on to the next part, that is what are the most common methods for phishing. So let's say, I think we can say that the most common methods are spoofed login pages that I can see most of the time. We can see that so many spoofed login pages in a particular phishing mail, that once we click on to the that URL, we will redirect to a attacker's web server or a web portal that it requires us to put our credentials, or it has a let's say a survey, but at the end it will ask for your credentials or your personal PIN or any data that the attacker requires. That is called spoofed login pages, that your datas will be captured in there and send it to the attacker. So the next one will be impersonation. So impersonations, in the sense, the attacker will try to capture your session cookies and kind of things, and so with using a impersonation technique, they will try to capture your cookies, your session tokens, and that kind of things with using a phishing attack. So move to the next one, that is malicious attachments. So malicious attachments, in the sense that we like it's a common thing that we regularly see a attachments in our spam box, or in our sometimes in our inbox also. So it says this is your let's say this is your credit details, or your bank statement, or your GST invoice, or your purchase history, or something like that. So some kind of attachment that it says. But when we look at it, or when we look on to the that email, we can we can see that this maybe this is a genuine mail. A regular user will think this is a genuine mail, that sometimes they won't check where it came from. For an example, it says HDFC Bank, and but that spelling is not that correct. It's the domain name is not that correct. It's not HDFC Bank. It's maybe something like HFDC Bank or something that. So the user will not look onto that, and he will not once the user will not confirm this, and he log the, he clicks onto that particular URL, and he will look for that, and he will thinks that the that domain is owned by the government, not the government, sorry, the bank, and it comes from it is a genuine mail, and he will try to open the malicious attachment. So when the user try to open this malicious attachment, what happens is the attachment the attachment does have some malicious let's say malwares injected in there. Let's say there are multiple ways to inject the malwares into a malicious documents, and so they can use macro, or they can do the other attack methods that I will cover in it sometime. So that will also end up in the attacker will compromise the victim. They will infect with malware, or they can control your PC or laptop. The next one will be messenger apps also. So we can also see that messenger apps, sometimes we are getting a mail says that we got a message from this particular messenger app, or let's say a message came from Facebook Messenger on our mailbox, and we will look and we'll give it a look, and we can see that this is looks like a genuine message from a user. The user was like, "Hey, how are you?" That's a message, and it shows in the email, and the user that mail says the user is waiting for your reply, and what a regular user will do is he looks to that mail and he can see that it's not a phishing mail, and he thinks this is a genuine, and he will click on to that particular URL, and the then rest is I think I don't want to say that. So that is called the messenger apps. There are some apps also for it's like making like a genuine app, and but it's not. And once the user will install that, they will also get infected with malwares. So moving to the next one is phishing with shared files. So phishing with shared files is also another thing that I have seen in a week or 2 weeks before that. I saw that in my mailbox actually, someone has been shared a voicemail with me. I have a demo like a screenshot of that. I'll show you that in a minute. So the attacker has shared a file, a voice clip with me, and it says I missed a voice clip from this particular number, and click open to that URL, and you can see the you can hear the missed voice clip. So I was like, yeah, this looks great. Actually, the biggest thing is like the attacker has put it as a trusted sender. He put that in HTML, he edited that code, and he put that in the top of the mail. It says in a green trusted sender. So once a regular user looks onto that, he thinks, yeah, this comes under trusted sender. But the one thing that has been there is, I think, the my employer shows as this comes from a external domain. So that is another one warning. But in below that there is I think that's a Outlook's regular one. So it says it's a trusted sender. So the I think one or two of them got confused because of this. They were like surprised, and that's how I came to know that this is a really nice attack, or a like a variety idea I could say. So that is also another kind of attack method, common method of phishing, with using the shared files also. So we'll move to the next slide. This is a typical framework I would say of a phishing attack. In the figure one, we can see that the attacker is sending a email or a phishing mail to the victim, and the victim is receiving the phishing mail. So the next one will be the figure two will be the victim falls into the suggested action. That is, the victim clicks on the phishing websites, and once he browse that particular phishing website, it asks him to download a file. I think it automatically downloaded, so it contains some malwares, and that is actually got automatically downloaded, and for a curiosity, I think the user has clicked on to that, and then his account will get compromised. So the third figure will be like jackpot for the attacker. He got the critical information, and the user's data has been stolen, and the user has been compromised also. So the attacker can do whatever he wants with using it. This is the typical framework, or like a let's say a method that I think the for a phishing attack. Before moving to this one, I can say that let's have some talk about the red teaming stuff here. So this let's look into the cyber kill chain here. This one is from Lockheed Martin's 2014. Released it. It's called the gaming the advantage applied in the cyber kill chain. So that is what it called. So the thing that it do is the it will do for the it will check for the first step will be reconnaissance in the sense it will get identify the target. So before that I could say this is a chain of attacks or actions that leads to a full compromise. I can say that again, this is the chain of attack that leads to a full compromise, in the sense it's starting from a initial perspective or initial entry point, then it will end in a particular action or an object or an end goal. Though the end goal will be sometime being an enterprise admin or a domain controller or kind of higher privileged user. So that may be a objective or maybe an end goal, or stealing some critical information, critical data that will be also infecting with a ransomware or the entire premises of a organization or something and asking for ransoms. So that will be also a objective. So these are the things that happening on with using this kill chain. So what the blue team can do is they can also follow this same method, and they can try to do once the adversary or attacker let's say he is on the third part in the delivery part and he is sending a phishing mail, and the once the blue team has know that he has done a reconnaissance and he has do a weaponization and he has created a backdoor or something, and he will going to send it through start a phishing spear phishing or targeted phishing campaign. So then they can also take necessary actions before the adversary do something or try to do any attacks on the particular that network. So they can also follow this full the chain of actions. So the first part will be reconnaissance, as in said, this is the identifying the targets that the attacker will harvest for all of the email address that he can collect, and most of the confidential information that has been publicly available on the internet, that he will collect most of the things passively or from the internet, like Shodan and from data breaches, all kind of things they can do. So the next one will be the weaponization, in the sense this will be the preparation of a attack or preparation of a operation, and this is where the attacker will create a malware or a backdoor, and the attacker will deliver this payload. So this is the step that he will prepare a FUD or a malware that he has to send with using a he has to start a phishing campaign, so a spear phishing campaign. So this is where the step that he will create payload or a command and control agent here. So Let's move to the third one. So this will be the delivery. So delivery in the sense, as I said before, this will be the launch of operation. This is where the attack, I think the attack will start. So this is the this is where the phishing and the kind of attacks will comes under this, the delivery part. So the attacker will deliver the payload that he has created before to the victim, like through email. That's the most common way they use, the attacker or a adversary use. And there is USB and like file sharing and kind of attacks will be there, but I think most of the time email through the payload will be delivered with using phishing and spear phishing, the targeted attacks that it comes under this delivery part. So moving on to the next one, this is the exploitation part. Exploitation part in the sense, this is where the attacker get a initial foothold on to the let's say organization. So he got he has been sent a targeted phishing mail before in the delivery part. So the victim or the user or a employee or an individual, that particular user got like he or she got hacked, or their account got compromised with they got like they fall into the attacker's hand, and they fall into that phishing attack. So they put their credentials, or they share their credentials in the that phishing mail or something, or they downloaded a malicious document or malicious payload that the attacker attacks. So then this is where the first initial compromise has been happened, and the first initial access has been got by the attacker. So that will get in here, that is called the exploitation part and getting access to the victim. And if the user also the attacker also will try to execute code on the victim's system here, this is what it happens. Like as I said, the document, the malicious document, as the user downloaded, and it will get executed in this part and will get a access from here. Yeah, move to the next one. Move to the next one. This is the installation part, that is the to establish a backdoor in the victim. Though the attacker has sent the malicious payload in here, and the victim has clicked on to it, and this is where the execution part will happen on here. So the malware will get installed on victim's machine, and next part will be the CNC, command and control. So the attacker will get access to the command and control. The attacker has a command and control server, so he can communicate through that CNC server with the victim's machine, and he can do whatever he want with using that CNC. So this is a command channel, I would say, for a remote manipulation, that I can say that a remote manipulation of a victim. So that I can say that for a command and control, so to remotely control the user, and that's the compromised user. So move to the next slide. This is This is the last and but not the least. This is action or objective to this is the last part of the chain. This is where the attacker will achieve a goal. As I said before, maybe the attacker need to be an enterprise admin or a higher privilege. Let's say higher privilege. We can call it as a higher privilege user. He needs to be a higher privilege user on the environment and or the organization, then he want to extract data, or he want to store, or he want to take critical client informations, critical employees informations, critical project informations, and all kind of critical data can be stolen, and maybe that part will comes under the action or a objective. So that is the end goal, I could say, achieve the mission goal. Yeah, that will be the end goal. That's what I call. So let's call it as same. This will be the end goal. So this is where the attack has been complete, and this is where the attacker has got what he wants, and the higher privileges, and yeah, most of the things for an attacker. So this is what the kill chain. So we'll move to the next part. This is called phishing campaign execution process. So this is the part that if you want to do a phishing campaign, so these are the process that you have to follow. So the first one will be you need to get an exact hardware. Hardware in the sense you need to get a VPS or a virtual private server, or if you have an on-prem server, or if you have your own private server, then you can get that also. If you doesn't have one, you have to purchase it from Google, Azure, AWS. There are a lot of options other. So you have to get the exact one that from on your requirement that you have to select. The next one will be the setup a infrastructure. Infrastructure in the sense you have to install a if for my case, I'm going to use GoFish. So if you are using GoFish, you have to install it on this step. You have to when you are setting up the infrastructure, you have to install all your tools, all your servers, all your web pages, all kind of things that you have to set in the this particular step, and you also want to configure a mail server in here in this step, ASMTP server. If you are going to use your own SMTP server, then you have to manually create it from here, or else you can purchase it from a SMTP service or some other websites or web services. SMTP services. So next one will be you have to buy a domain. So for that you can take you can check for expireddomains.com. I think I have that on my next slide. I guess I'll show you that. From that you have to order a domain. You have to take a domain that is similar to the target that you are going to do a campaign or a phishing attack. So you need a particular domain for that, and the next one will be you have to inform the authorities. Authorities in the sense when you are doing a phishing campaign for a client, that you have to inform them that you are going to do this at the so and so time, and that kind of information that you have to inform you have to inform the POC and maybe I mean I'm not sure the CTO level or the let's say the manager level must be aware of this, and the security guy or someone from the security team must be aware of this, and a higher person or a higher executive level employee will also need to aware of this kind of activities when it's happening on a corporate level, or if you are going to do these assessments or campaigns on for a like let's say FAS, the phishing assay service. When you are doing that, you have to make sure you do this all these steps. So before starting your campaign, you have to do a test run. Anyways, if this is not a spray and pray attack, so you have to be careful. So once this is a target attack, so when you send a particular mail or a single mail, once the user, or let's say I'll give you an example. So you have sent a let's say 20 emails to different 20 employees in that organization. So the two or three employees has got suspicious and they report it back to the support team, and they report it to the security team, and then the security team has, or the enterprise security or any team that who handles these phishing kind of things, the mail security team will block your IP, block the domain name, and blacklist the IP and domain name in the abused IPs and phishing and spam kind of IPs in their particular database. So the domains, let's say the domains health and domains popularity and kind of things will get decreased if you are not testing it, you are not doing a test run, because you already send this without testing. So it will get detected and it will block from your end, and then you don't have any options. So you have to start it from scratch, or else if you are doing a redirector, then you are good to go. But if you are not using, then you are screwed. You have to do everything from the scratch. Then the next one will be the starting in the campaign, so that you have to once you do a test run or a dry run, you can confirm that this is getting to the inbox of a particular employee or someone that you have a POC, or you can try check that, or few things that this bypass the firewall and this looks genuine and it's not raised any flag in the organization, then you can definitely start the campaign from there on. And then the last one will be evaluate the results. So evaluate the results in the sense that you have to check for the user whom all are clicked on that your phishing link, or whom all are opened your email, and who all are filled there, if it has a survey form or anything, or a login page, they who all are submitted the data in there, and that kind of things that you can at the end you can get it, and you will have the data, then you can take everything from the dashboard, and if you are using Office, then you can export it as, and you can give it back to the client, and you can rectify it and give it back to the client. So that's the last step of a phishing campaign execution process. So this is how a phishing campaign should do, or this is the step, the necessary steps that you have to do when you are doing a phishing campaign actually. So moving to the next one, so we will be looking for the phishing setup. So there are multiple tools, multiple frameworks that are available in the internet right now. So there are easy web-based phishing that you can use. You can just send you can just set up a SMTP mail server. I think you can use iRedMail that you you have that is available on the GitHub. You can set it up with in your particular VPS or anywhere. Then you can send it. I think it has a inbuilt mailbox, so you can start sending mail from there. So that's a easy web-based phishing that you can send it right away. You don't want to depend on any other dashboards or any other frameworks. So the next one will be Cobalt Strike phishing. So Cobalt Strike phishing is as in Cobalt Strike, there is a module called Cobalt Strike phishing. So from there you can start your own phishing campaigns with using Cobalt Strike. If you are using Cobalt Strike, you can use that as well. Sorry, I missed that. The next one will be the phishing frameworks. That there are multiple frameworks in there. GoFish is one of them that I am personally using right now, and Lucy is there, and Phishing Frenzy is a really good tool, and there is SET, it's Social Engineering Toolkit, that has been also used by so many guys. So these are the different type of a frameworks and different type of a phishing setup. If you want a aggressive one, you can go with that. If you want a basic kind of thing, you can always go with the easy web-based phishing. So moving to the next one, this is the this is an example phishing infrastructure. This is not, it doesn't have any like, let's say, CNC and the command and control servers and kind of things. I just made this as for my purpose, again, for the demo or for this session. I have created this particular infrastructure. So this is what the attacker has domain, and he has the SMTP server, and he has a Apache redirector. So once, if the attacker, if the mail server has get blocked, and if that you can add it into the that middle part of the SMTP servers, then it will once the SMTP the Apache redirector or the reverse proxy server got blocked, then you can only, you only want to change that particular redirector or the reverse proxy. So you don't want to change all the phishing payload and phishing hostel servers and SMTP main servers, or not, you don't want to do that. You just want to change the redirector's IP. So that is the best thing if you are going to do any phishing campaigns in future, and if you want to do multiple phishing campaigns with using a single single platform. So you just want to change the redirect, and you just want to change the reverse proxies. So that's all that you need. So move to the next part. This is where I am going to tell you how you can set up a phishing infrastructure. So you need to create your own mail server in here. If you are going to use your own mail server, you have to set your own SMTP server, or there are some other SMTP services that you can choose, like Mailgun, SendGrid, and that kind of SMTP services that you can choose. The best thing is that most of them will have a good reputation, in the sense they have a good domain health, they have a good reputation, and most of the times these domains will get bypassed on to the victim's account mail or mailbox. So it's good to use the services, but you can, if you are let's say pro, you can create your own mail server. That's a bit pain in the ass, because you have to the postfix will give you a headache. Anyways, you have to make sure you are doing everything correct, and so yeah. So the next one will be you have to try you have try to you have to try to buy expired domains from expireddomains.net. You can check this particular URL and you can see what are the expired domains that you can buy it from there. So the main advantage is that you will the that particular domains will have a good health because it will be so much like let's say 3 or 4 years older, and it will have a good reputation. Sometimes it some of the domains has good reputation and good domain health also. So there might be a chance these domains will get bypassed on the mail security and firewalls also. So that's a good thing you can do. You can buy it from the expired domains.net. Also, you have to collect all the details and start generating sending profiles. So this is the thing that you have to do when you are doing you are setting an infra, that you have to collect and you have to create a particular sending profile, and you have to set the first name, last name, and the email or the destination if you want that all particular and you have to make that, I think. Yeah, collect all the details and start generating sending profile. So so create the web server that the targets will be asked to get to in the phishing mail. So I think you have to create a web server that the targets when the victim or the target clicks on to that phishing email, that it needs to be redirected to a website or a server that has the server has need to be the servers needs to host the particular phishing page or phishing domain, so that you need a server also. So you need to make the phishing page looks legit because in this time, like most of the people will get to know if you are using a old-fashioned Facebook login page that you are still using the 2018's back Facebook page, and it is. You're still using that, then there might be a chance it will raise a flag and the user will think that or he will try to re-verify this. This is actually a genuine URL or it's a fake one, so there might be a chance for that also. And so you need to make your phishing page looks legit. You need to make that. Then you have to make sure your domain is categorized. That's I said that the domain is to be a categorized domain, and you need a good health, you need a better reputation also, that will also bypass the firewalls and email securities also. Then you have to this I think this is a must one. I could say if you are using, you have to use a SSL certificate. There is Let's Encrypt. Let's Encrypt will provide free SSL certificates for you. You can register from there and you can generate your own certificate with using Let's Encrypted. And what it does is what it will do is these SSL certificate will make the website looks so much promising. It's like the user will check for the that blue, not the blue, the green tick and the green mark that on the URL part your box. So user will check that, and the victim or the user will see that there is a HTTPS and this is a green bar. It has a green bar and the website is secure, and he thinks this is not a fake website and this is a genuine one. So there is also one another possibility of spoofing a user. Then you have to create a landing page. Then once the user has clicked on your particular phishing email link, and once the victim get to that URL and he will land to a let's say a login page or something. Once the credentials has been submitted, these need to be landed on some let's say some pages in there. So that is also need to create from your side, and you have to create a decoy pages. So you have to create you need to be on the genuine side. You need a genuinity, so you have to make sure these all are these all are does or do from your end. You keep this in mind. So we'll move to the next one. So this is again the phishing infra setup. You need to implement the phishing redirectors. So that I said before, if your one of your IP get blocked, that you need to start everything from the scratch. So that is a really awful job that you have to do. This is so this is really hard to do. So you have to keep in mind that this if you are doing it for a longer run, you need to do phishing redirect. So once the IP get blocked, you can easily change the redirect IP. Then you can still use the alt, the backend servers. You just want to change the redirectorized IP. That's how it works. Then you have to make sure this the below options, and to get a 100, a 10 out of 10 domain reputation. So these are the must things that you have to do when you are doing when you are setting up an infrastructure for a phishing campaign. You have to set up the SPF records, and you have to set up the DKIM and the DMARC, and you have to set up an encryption for that, and you have to configure your PostFix as a relay. You have to use another services and PostFix as a relay also, and you have to sanitize the email headers. You have to hide the email headers, and you have to sanitize the email headers and remove the default ones and the headers of the email servers and the origin server or the origin the headers. These email headers needs to be obfuscated from the originating mail server or the phishing server. So that is another thing that you these are the continual things that you have to follow when you are going to set up an infra for phishing. So moving to the next part, we are still we need to if you are doing an infra setup, you have to take or you have to generate malicious documents, and you have to generate the payloads for you. So there are multiple tools that available on the internet that you can use. These are the most common ones, and or the one that I use to create a macro based payloads. I usually use Metasploit or CobraStrike or Empire, etc. etc. There are some other tools also, and you can check that in Google, or there are so many tools available in GitHub. You can give it a try. Also, you can use obfuscated with VPAT. So there's another good tool. You can obfuscate your payload. Also, you can check the all bins. You there are the some other you have so many bins in there, bin files in there. So you have to check that, and you have to use the invoke DOS obfuscation, sorry, the obfuscation code that you also can use. That is a, I think, yeah, that's a PowerShell script that you can use, and there are Evil Clippy, and there are some other tools called abusing the Silk file format, and that's a techniques that you can use, and you have to embed the oily objects, and that kind of attacks are all kind of attacks that you can use. There are some other attacks that I couldn't include. There are multiple ways of attacks that you can do in the malicious payload generations and malicious document generations when you are using a phishing campaign, when you are doing a phishing campaign. So these are the things that you basically need as in it malicious payload generation. So moving to the next slide, we have to do for the some final steps that we have to let's say we have to follow up These are the final steps that we need to follow when you are doing setting up an infrastructure. So you need to create templates, email templates, and you have to personalize them. You have to update it with the malicious links and kind of things. You have to create your own personalized emails, templates, personalized landing pages, personalized decoy pages, or personalized websites, fake phishing pages, and kind of things that you have to do. I don't recommend that you use the ones that are available on the internet. You need to make some changes onto that. Yeah, that's what I say. Email templates can be anything between plain and very complex. That's up to you. You can do that. You can do a complex one. You can, your template has be a like a, let's say a basic one, or if you want to make it complex and it look like you have to work so much on to that particular template, and you have to let's say you have to work on that, you have to edit that, and you have to give some time on making a template, custom template. So that will help, that will get help. So then the next one will be there are several templates are online. If you are going to take on, I think I can refer that you can use the especially you can use the marketers templates. So they are good at some some of them are good at bypassing the spam filters. And the next one will be it's always a good idea to personalize malicious link and landing pages too. That I already covered. You have to manually edit your landing page, and you have to manually personalize your malicious links and make it looks like a genuine one. That's up to you, that you have to do it from your end. And always test your this is the main part that you have to do. As I said, if your IP or domain get blocked, that will be a huge problem for you if you're doing a phishing campaign. Before starting a campaign, you always have to test your email prior to sending. And you can use the website mail-tester.com. So I think I have used it so much, and this is a good success so far. So you can always use that also for your phishing infra setup. So the next will be you also can the last thing that you have to do is you have to send the phishing mail, and you have to or the start the campaign, and you have to wait for it, because most of the time it will take some time to get reach to the particular employees, the targets, and there are might be a 50-50 chance that the user will get clicks, or user will get clicked on to that particular phishing URL, or the particular let's say the attachment or something. So there will be less chance, so we need to be patient. The attacker needs to be patient, and that's what it was, the phishing requires a patience. Yeah. Unless you want to combine it with wishing or smishing, that you can do. If you want, you send a mail to the particular target, and you will call them, and you will say that you are, for an example, you are calling from an ABC insurance, and you have sent a particular claim form, or you got selected to the let's say the minister's relief fund, and you are supposed to fill those documents before a date. He says a date, or the attacker says a date, and that you have to follow, and you see that you can see that there is a mail in your inbox, and you have to check, you have to download that attachment, and you think this is a genuine one, and because the employee or the insurance person was called you and he told these are the things that you have to do, and he says he convinced you as this is a genuine one. So that is also another thing. There will be that's called wishing. So there, if you are integrating this wishing also, that will be the increase or the success rate will go up. That's what I can say, that the success rate will be up when you are doing a phishing campaign, when you combine it with wishing or smishing. So move to the next one. This is the phishing framework setup that we are going to do. So we are going to do the GoFish setup. So we are going to create a new SMTP profile. So under the sending profile, you have to select it on the GoFish portal. Once you have to download the GoFish and you have to set it on your on-prem, and you have to select the sending profile on the drop-down box, and you have to put your like a unique name or a fitting name that you want. You can put anything you want, and you can add an interface type, and you have to choose that SMTP, and for from type your email address. Your email address in the sense that this is the one that you are going to send, or the one that is going to be delivered on the victim's mailbox. So that's what you have to send. That's the the email that you have to create when you created your SMTP server, or if you are using a SMTP service, then you have to use their own SMTP username and email. And for the host part, that you have to put your host name or the IP of your mail server, that if you have a SMTP server, that you have to put, or if you are using a service, you have to put their own servers IPs or a domain name. For username, type your SMTP username. You have to use your SMTP username that you have been created before when you create or when you set up your SMTP server. Then you can use the same password when that's the same thing. This is all on the same part. When you create SMTP server, these all things will you will get all these options, or all these things, all these details you will get when you create a custom SMTP server, or if you are using service also you will get these credentials. So you can check, you can do a send test mail using the button that you can see it on screen. From there it will try to send a test mail to the particular email that you are given in there. Then you can test that the credentials and the SMTP server is working. After that you can save the profile. You can also untick the ignore certificate errors, because sometimes there will be some SSL or certificate errors, so you have to make sure that the campaign does not stop because of a certificate error. If you want, you can untick that. To move to the next one, we have a GoFish setup, and we have to create the templates. So we have to create a template in the sense we have to, this is how it looks like. So we have to create a template for the email. So this is the email template. So this is the email template that we have to create. So first we have to navigate to the email templates part path, and you have to click on the new template button. Then you can start creating your own template. You can put your name, any name you want, and you can put the subject, and you can put a subject, and put the template as in a text or in a HTML form. If you want to make it a bit complex, you can put the you can design your own template and you can put it in here. So that's what it does. So we'll move to the next one, that is we are going to do the we are going to create the landing page. So we are going to create a landing page. Landing page in the sense you will once the victim or a target clicks on the particular URL, he or she will land on this particular page. So you have to set it here. If you want to capture passwords or if you want to capture any credentials or anything, there is a option called capture credentials or save data. So you can tick that and you will get once the victim types any kind of credentials, you'll get that in here. You have to put a check, or you have to put a input box as a username and password. That is, you have to make sure, and you can put your own landing page template also here. So this is another thing, a must thing that you have to do once you are setting up a GoFish. So we will go to the next one. So we are creating the groups in the sense the group of targets or the peoples or the targets that we are going to send emails, or the victims of the, let's say the victims of the this particular phishing campaign. So from in here you have to put the first name, last name, the email, if you know the position of that particular employee or individual, you can also put that. So that is another good thing that you have to do. This is another good thing that GoFish provides. Then we'll move to the next one. This is the campaign part. So this is where we have to start our campaign. Once we have set up all the sending profiles, groups and landing pages and our template, we can start the new campaign. You have to go to the campaigns part and you have to click the new campaign, and you have to pick a name. I think all of you can see the screen. In the screenshot, you can put your name, pick a name of the campaign. Let's say ABC Corporation's phishing simulation or phishing campaign, and you can put the email template that you have created before. You can select it from the drop down menu and you can put the URL. That's it. You have to put the GoFish URL. You have to put your own GoFish, where is GoFish is running, that you have to put the URL. If it's a domain name, you have to put that. And the time that you have to send, if you can also schedule this attack. If you want to do this on tomorrow night or tomorrow work hours or any day like next week or anything, you have to you can set it on here and you just click start. It will not start, it will wait for the time or the specific time that we set to come, and at that time only it will start the campaign. So that's also a good thing to do if you want to schedule your campaigns, phishing campaigns. So you can after that you can choose your sending profile. That's your SMTP credentials, SMTP the mail server that you are going to send, and you can choose the group, according group in the sense, as I said, if you want to only to target a set of managers, let's say you have created a set of managers of a ABC corporation, then you can only select the managers group. If you want to send it to let's say senior employees, you can send it to the senior employees only. If you want to target more than that, the entire employees, if you have created a group regarding according to them, then you can also select that also. Okay, so moving to the next part, this is the GoFish results page, or the campaigns results, I can say. This is the campaigns results that you can see it on the screen. When you start a campaign, you can see the particular results in here, whom all are, the how many mails has been sent, how many is on queue, how many yet to send, and that kind of things, and who all are clicked on the URL, who all are opened the mail in their mailbox. Because to check that, you have to put a tracker code that you can do, that is actually default. Like I think that is a, it's already inbuilt in the template, mail template, as default. So you don't want to manually add. If it's not there, you can refer the GoFish document and you can add the tracker custom trackers. And if you want, you can add custom trackers as a image, and you can add custom trackers. You can just convert it to Base64 and you can add your custom trackers also. The next one is the captured credentials. I think the credential that captured that will be also in there. Then you can see that also if you put the credential capture option turned on, you can see that in here also. So move to the next part. So I can show you some real world examples. So this is called a link manipulation. So I think from the screen you can see that manipulating the links. For example, you can see facebook.com. It's not actually facebook.com. It's instead of facebook.com, so but it looks like facebook.com. Once we see this kind of mails on your mailbox, we usually don't check that. We see that the four letters are face. Oh yeah, it looks like Facebook. We didn't notice that this is not a genuine one, and we won't recognize this as a phishing mail. Sometimes if you see this particular mail, so every time when you are seeing something like this, please make sure or please be assured that you are checking this, and you are checking for the misspelled URLs and the subdomains. And this is the most common trick that used by an attackers. So this is another example. So I think you can spot the difference in here, because this is the same domain that the Paul Moore was, he's a security guy who purchased it. So I think even though I couldn't also understand what is the difference once I just saw this. So this is like when a scammer buys a URL, that includes characters or that appear to be English letters. So it's like lloydsbank.co.uk, but these are the different language. It's called homographic attacks. It's called homographic attacks that you can use. It looks like once it converted from UTF, I think it will be the same character, but in the backend or in the same the domain name, it's not English letter. It will be Latin or any other language. So that's how the difference. So Paul Moore, he bought lloydbank.co.uk. He used the capital I instead of the L, because lloydbank.co.uk, he purchased the iiloydsbank.co.uk. II in the sense he purchased that in the capital letter. So that looks like lloydbanks.co.uk. This is a really bad thing if you are seeing this, and you will definitely fall into this kind of attack. Even though I also couldn't find the difference between these two domains. So make sure that you are using the genuine or fishy mail URL. So you have to make sure that. And so this is another interesting tactics by an attacker. So that this is the one I was explaining before. So this is like from the mail, the sender says this is a trusted sender. So the most of the some of the employees has been seized this, and they were like, yeah, this is trusted sender, as the mail security team has been already put it or labeled it as a trusted sender. So there is no problem, then we can open it the attachments or something. But as in the top it says it's external mail, but the attacker used a tactic or trick. This is an interesting tactic. He used as a it's a trusted center. Yeah, stresses of it's came from a trusted source. So that's how these kind of at a real world examples are. So you have to be careful. So this is another real world example. This email looks like a legitimate, but typically it's not very personal. This is a basic phishing attack. So I'll show you another image. This is the spear phishing attack. I think if you can see that this is in the mail header, mail body. It says hi John. It particularly ask sending it to a targeted user. The attacker knows this will he is sending it to John, and he knows he's definitely targeting it on the this is a spear phishing or a targeted attack. So but back in here you can see it says just hi, because the attacker doesn't know who he's sending this to, because he's just sending it to a multiple amount of employees or a multiple amount of peoples that he came from. He got the email address publicly from other public platforms, so he's just using that. Again, move to the next part. So how you can identify a phishing email. So most of the time the companies will not ask for your sensitive information via email, because they won't ask this kind of you don't want to fill your account details or login informations and that kind of things in your phishing email. So this is the next point that you have to check that the message is sent from a public email domain, because I think this is a Gmail or something. So this is a public email domain. So from a genuine, it's not from a genuine sender. So this is like the like a let's say PayPal doesn't use a public email domain like Gmail or anything for their own mail as a mail service, because they already has their own let's say they already has their own private their particular email service with using paypal.com. And the next one will be the how to identify a phishing mail. So the email will be poorly written, so most of the time it has grammatical errors and it has some alignment errors or kind of things. So you have to check for that also. And it includes suspicious attachments or links that also a phishing like a flag to raise, or we can check, or we will be suspicious that this will be attachment that contains malware or anything. This is a suspicious one, then you have to check for that, or you have to confirm whether it's not it's a genuine one or not. And the domain name is misspelled. That is the biggest thing that you have to check also, that I showed on the before. And to how to prevent phishing. So you need to keep informed about the phishing, latest phishing techniques that is happening on right now. So you have to get updated every time, and then think before you click. If you are seeing a URL, just think about a second for a second, then just when you are clicking, be careful for that. You can also install an anti-phishing toolbars for sometimes. You can do that, and the most of the phishing attacks, some of the phishing attacks or phishing URLs will get detected, and it will block it from the browser part also, browser and the email part. So you have to verify site security. So you can check for the site health and site reputation, and how when the domain has been purchased, and that kind of things that you can also check. And you can check the website has a certificate, but most of the time nowadays you can see that all the phishing website has SSL certificates. You can check your online accounts regularly, as in this. Sorry, you can check your online accounts security regularly. In the sense, you have to check your you have to change your passwords every 3 weeks or 1 month, or you have to change it regularly. I mean, like that's up to you. You have to change your own passwords and kind of things regularly. Just don't use the same password for every time. So that's also another thing. So you have to keep your browsers also up to date, and you have to use a good firewall or an antivirus to block from the virus attacks and malware attacks. So be wary of pop-ups. So you have to be careful about pop-up and the other attacks also. So the next one will be you never give out your personal information in the internet. Don't give it away. Give it away. Just be careful when you are giving your personal information about the internet. So because most of the targeted attacks has been done by with using the personal information that you have shared, and you have to do that. So just every time look for the S in the website, HTTPS, just check for it as a SSL certificate when you are trying to input a password or something. Then there might be a chance there is a man in the middle or anything happens. So just be careful on that also. Also the HTTPS, just check that the domain or subdomain has a HTTPS or it has a SSL certificate. Then the main thing that you have to use a two-factor authentication once, or if your account got your password has been breached and your password has been publicly available or it breached on a platform or something. Then if you have a two-factor authentication, then that might save you from not the attackers not getting to the log into your account. So make sure you are using two-factor authentication on everywhere, like your banking, social network, and everywhere if you can. Just please do that. This is the best thing, that trust your gut instincts. So because if you are seeing a mail that you looks like you think this is not a genuine one, then trust your guts, yeah, and instincts. Then there might be a chance that it's not genuine. It might be a phishing. So if you think that this is not genuine, then please recheck or re-verify that and confirm that this is genuine or not. That is the best thing that you have to do. I think that's all from my end. If you have any questions, I think you have to ask. I'll be on the booth on this session, after the session. So if you have any questions, you can ask there, or if you have any other questions, you can ping me on the my Twitter. This is my LinkedIn profile also. You can send your queries to me, and I'll try to solve this at any time. So if I can, yeah, sure, I'll do that. No worries. I think that's all from my end for this session. So if you have any queries also, there's a Discord channel in DEFCON Trivandrum. So we are officially supporting everyone, and if you have you can just join here, and you can, if you have any queries, you can post it there. There are so many members that who will help you if you have any anything, or if you have any queries, that there might be a chance it will get solved quickly. So I think that's all from me and today. So thanks everyone for hearing my session, and thanks Diana Initiative, and thanks for Team Village for it. Bye bye, take care.